Welcome, bet riders around the world. My name is Gary Solomon, and you're watching the Laidback Bike Report. I'm coming to you live from the Laidback Bike Studios in Pickerington, Ohio, where we produce this monthly webcast that can be watched live or viewed later on YouTube. Now, if you're wondering how you can support us, if you look down in the lower right-hand corner of your screen, you'll see a little red subscribe button. If you'll click that, that helps us a lot, subscribes you to our YouTube channel. And in the upper right-hand corner, you will see a little letter I that stands for information, and that's what it'll give you. If you click on it, you'll find a way to get to our website and find more information and other ways to support us here at the Laidback Bike Report. I'd like to talk to you for a minute about how you can participate in today's show. We have a YouTube live chat running, and if you're watching on the web, you will see it just to the side of the video screen that you're watching on. So feel free to jump in there, ask questions, make your comments. It's a great way to participate in the show and become a part of it. And we love to see your questions and comments. And if they're good ones, we'll bring them up to our guests or our panelists. So please avail yourself of that. If you happen to be watching on Bent Rider or Facebook or Twitter, you can click through to the YouTube channel from there and you'll be able to see that live chat window. Well, let's at this point talk about what's coming up on this show today. We have a really good show lined up for you, as I like to think we always do. We have an interview with a very special guest that I will introduce in a minute. We have a special Velomobile report from our good friend and panelist, Josef. We have Bryan's report from the Laidback News Desk. And unfortunately, Denny's not with us today, but he did submit a great sports report. And Bryan's going to go ahead and give a shot at reading that for us, too. So Bryan's going to be busy today. Dana is not with us either today. He's got a family emergency. And so we're going to move on after that right to the Google Plus Recumbent Bike Rider Community Business. We'll talk about the contests of the month and the sorts of things that we do in the community on Google Plus. Folks, I'd like to take a minute at this point to talk to you about our sponsor this month and a very special recumbent bike. And there we go. Here's what Bryan Ball said when the Linear Roadster was voted Bent Rider Bike of the Year in 2011. "The Roadster is also the best handling underseat steering bike I have ever ridden. And now it's also available in an over the seat steering version that handles just as sweetly." And then in 2016, the new Linear Folding Roadster won again. "With the sporty Euromesh seat, it weighs only 30.5 pounds and is priced under $2,900. The Linear Roadster is available with a folding frame so that you can easily put it in a small car, even behind the back seat of a Scion XA. With a 5mm Allen wrench, you can loosen 3 or 4 screws and take one in a CrateWorks travel case. The long wheelbase Linear Limo is also available with a folding frame for touring. Can you fit your big comfy bike in a Corvette? It's a folding Linear Limo. If it's a folding Linear Limo, you sure can. And it can be done in under 2 minutes. That's quick. So stay tuned for a special limited time offer from Linear that we'll be talking about at the end of the show. And at this point, I'd like to talk to you a minute about who is on the show as panelists today. First of all, from South Florida, our media specialist, Carl Kidd. Hello, Carl.
Hey, Gary. Hello, everyone. Of course, you know, I have to give that shout out to the number one fan of the Laidback Bike Report, my 91-year-old mother, Wanda, who joined Gary and I and all of the Bent riders here in South Florida for a nice ride when Gary got out of the cold north and came down to sunny Florida. So welcome to everyone. Looking forward to the show. Thanks, Gary.
Attaboy, Carl and Wanda. Nice to have you watching again as usual. All right, next, we're going to talk about the man, the beard, the legend from Cold Spring, Kentucky. Not Carl, but yes, Larry Varney. Also, I believe a birthday boy by just a couple of days. Isn't that right, Larry?
Yeah. Hi, everybody. See, what today? I don't know. But anyway, a couple of days ago, I turned the big 70. So I'm already starting to turn senile. But I got an early start on that anyway. So, but it's good to be on the show and to see everybody. And hopefully I'll make it down to Florida again and get to be a little bit further south and go take a ride with you, Carl.
Very good. All right, Bryan, go ahead and shoot yourself, as we like to say. Can you shoot yourself?
No one likes to say that, Gary. That's not a thing.
From Rochester, New York, the founder and editor of Bent Rider and the anchor of the Laidback News Desk. That is Bryan Ball right there. Yeah, Bryan, thanks so much for being on.
No problem.
All right. And now we're going to go to Bonn, Germany, where we welcome back a special Velonaut and also a Velomobile tour captain. He is Josef Janning. Josef, hello there. Welcome back to the show.
Hello, Gary. Hello, everyone. It's a pleasure to be back. It's a pleasure to be riding.
And looking at the kinds of Velomobiles you ride, it would be a pleasure. You ride some amazing things. Well, we're gonna talk about all that a little bit later on. Welcome, and we'll talk to you a little later, Josef. And our last panelist from Dallas, Texas, we welcome back the Velonaut known as Mr. Wizard in many corners, Doug Davis. Hey, Doug. Doug, you're muted, I think. Nope. All right. Well, you know what? First of all, it's a very nice background you have there. It's better than last year. It doesn't show that you're muted. I'm not sure what's going on. Let's get on with the last of our panelists, and we'll get back to you, Doug. You work on that. This actually is a trifecta of Velonauts on our panel today. This guy has a Velomobile blog that he puts out, very knowledgeable in the world of Velomobiles. He was on our show last year, and we welcome back from Ottawa, Canada, Luke Fournier. Hi, Luke.
Hello. Nice to be with you.
It's great to have you. It's great to have you. Okay, folks. Bryan, come on back to me. Thank you. Last February, one of our most popular shows ever, we took a broad look at the Velomobile. We discussed its history, features, and the many varieties of Velomobiles that are currently ridden. I promised then that it would not be our last show about this subject, and today, on our webcast, we make good on that pledge. I first met today's guest last year at Spezi. During our interview at the Katanga booth, he talked to me about his small company based in the Czech Republic. He then went on to show me the Velomobiles that he produces. They're called WAW. He impressed me then as someone who is well-versed in and most capable of speaking for the Velomobile industry. So for today's show titled The Making of a Velomobile, I feel very fortunate to have as our guest Stephane Boving. Hello, Stephane.
Hello, Gary. Thanks for inviting me. Hello to everybody. Hello to the public.
Very nice to have you. So let's get right to it, and we'll ask you a few general questions here. Maybe you can answer and fill in some of the things that people think about. Those that know a lot about Velomobiles may know the answers here, but I'm sure there's plenty of people watching who don't. So let's start out with your company. Can you tell us a little bit of the history of Katanga?
Yes, Katanga was created in 2011. I wanted to start a company in which I really like to work, and which combines a lot of interests like bicycling, ecology, production, global entrepreneurship, open to the whole world, for which Czech Republic is very well placed. So I created this company, and I started by visiting all producers and speak to people. And in 2012, we took over the WAW, and then we started to produce it here. We started with R&D, and in 2014, we created a new version of the WAW, WAW 2014. Last year, we again upgraded this to WAW 2016, And since recently, now 2 months, we are in new buildings where we hope now to grow further and to do more production of WAWs, but also combine with other projects and special bicycles.
Okay. Yeah, we're going to talk a little bit about that as well. And leading into our slideshow with some of the pictures that are going to describe everything that that goes into making a Velomobile, I was wondering if you could tell us about some of the facilities that are used in the making of these parts. Where are they located? What do each of them do? And then we're going to take a look at what it is they do more specifically. Where are they and what do they do?
Yeah, so our strategy is not to do everything ourselves. We work with partners. We have approximately 10 companies which we really work in close partnership. And every company specializes in something else. So Katanga, our company, is coordinating everything, is doing the R&D. But for the production of the parts are all produced outside the company. And then finally, when the parts arrive here, we assemble them here and we ship them to the dealers and the customers. So this permits us to stay a small, flexible company, but to use the skills and the qualities of real professional companies. Most of these companies are here around us, but one important company, the one of which you will see the pictures, the producer of the laminated parts, is a company of Mr. Pavlik in Slovakia. It's 120 kilometers from here. Most other companies, like the metal producing companies, the partner for the engines, for the electro parts, they are closer. They are around the city of Brno here.
And Brno, which I don't, maybe you said it already, but Brno and where you are is in the Czech Republic. Is that correct?
Yes, indeed.
All right. Just want to make sure we establish that. All right. I think it's time now for us to really kind of drill down and get a good look at what goes into making a Velomobile, all the parts and all the design, all these things. Stephane worked very hard over the last couple of weeks to put together a number of pictures that will describe quite delicately what it is that goes into it. So, Carl, if you are ready with the slideshow pictures. Carl, I don't see them. There we go. And if you want to present those, Bryan, very good. Everyone can see them now. Can you see them okay, Stephane?
Yes, I see them well.
All right. So we're going to go through these pictures, some of them more quickly and some not. And you start telling us, if you would, what we're looking at here. Maybe at the very beginning, describe, if you would, the whole process real quickly in an outline. And then we're going to go through each part of the process with these pictures.
Yeah. So all these pictures are for the producer, from the producer of the laminated part, Mr. Pavlik. And we start with pictures where we will show how we make models and forms. So this is a model of which we will make a later form. This is the mirror cap, the aerodynamic.
Okay, if I could just stop you for a second, because this was not clear to me until you explained it. I want to make sure this is very clear to everyone as we start here. So the process is that you design the Velomobile by making models of the various sections and parts. From those models, you can correct me if I'm wrong here, Stephane. From those models, you make forms. And the forms then are used to laminate the and make the parts that actually are part of the Velomobile. Is that correct? Did I describe
That's
that properly?
That's correct. Maybe to clarify a little better, you can say the model looks the same like the final part, and the form is in a negative copy of the final part.
Good. And so what we're looking at here are some pictures of the models. Go ahead. I didn't mean to interrupt.
This one was drawn with 3D program and milled in polyurethane. The previous picture of the central part of the body was in fact just a part that we made stronger, thicker, because we took over the wall. It was an existing product. So we didn't drone everything ourselves. We continued by adapting an existing part. So we first make this part, and then we start removing material or add material. Here you see nose and tail fairings. These are all models. Here you see again central parts where we adapt the whole rear part because we wanted to add a rear suspension. So you see where we add material and remove. there are a lot of pictures, so we will go through it. And it's difficult to go into explaining every last detail.
Go ahead, Carl. There you go.
So I work then very closely with these people. I go there one or twice a week when there is a big development going on. And they added a part for the chain. And then now this is the process of making a form. So they will make a dividing line, because most of the parts one or two or three forms even to get the product out. So this is a tail where they already prepared half of the form. And once half of the form is ready, then they will laminate further and make the second form.
Stephane, could you you explained it to me. I think it's worth stopping for a second. Could you explain why you have to break it down into two or three parts for two or three forms for some parts?
Because otherwise, it's impossible to get a product out of it. That's the main reason why a form is separated.
Yeah, and we're going to see near the end here how the process of removing the parts, and you'll see why that is. Okay, thank you. Go ahead.
So this is the cover also before we start to change things on it. This is already one half of the form for the nose fairing. This is again an example where we made the model and the form with 3D design with modern technology. This is a nicer way to work, but the condition is then that you start that your whole bike is made like this, not only one part. This is for the WAW 2014, the bridge which covers the direction between the front wheel wells. It starts here with a wooden model that I made myself, and then I bring it to the Slovak company, who will work it out, make the surface perfect, adapt so that it fits.
And the different materials that you kind of glanced just touched on that. Can you tell us again what are some of the materials you used in making the models?
The previous picture, it was just wood, because I had that available, and I don't have the best material for it. But usually they use polystyrene or polyurethane. You can go to high density polyurethane. This is a nice product if you really want to mill it and to have already very good definition. But the company in Slovakia, they are used more to work manually, so they prefer to work with lighter foams, so polyurethane but lighter version.
Okay, polyurethane. Okay, go ahead, Carl, move it if you can. There you go.
Yeah, so
another version. Go ahead, Carl. Yeah, that's it.
Go ahead. Yeah, so yep. With the WAW, the tail and the nose fairing has to adapt as good as possible to the central part. So this needs a lot of attention. And this you see here on the picture.
Roll it, Carl. There you go.
So this process takes at least 2 months, let's say, because we don't like to do it fast. We like to look at every step also.
What's going on here?
This is the upper part, the upper form from the central part of the bike. Yeah. Okay. So you recognize the entry hole to enter. Yeah. So just a picture of this.
Okay. Next, form. Carl.
This is the model that I brought there that has been reworked. The surface has been done well. They add paint and then they brush it with very fine sandpaper till the surface is perfect.
Okay.
Also a form, the left under part of the central body of the WAW. Mm-hmm. Here you see how they spray the paint. And this is the first product that they got out of the new forms. Yeah. There's also a big question if we can get it out of the form and how it will look like.
That could be problematic, I guess, from what you were telling me, isn't it?
Yes, it's going to happen. Uh-huh.
Okay. Continue, Carl, go ahead. Mm-hmm.
This is already, again, a new model that you make for about 2016. So it's made then in very thick glass fiber. you can go through the photos, pictures, Carl.
Yep, go ahead, Carl. Run them through unless Stephane tells you to stop.
Yeah, here we make chain protection. So you see the polystyrene, which is used as basic material for the model. Same part. Here you see the drawing of a part. It had to fit to be glued in the WAW, so it has to fit on the WAW. But with just a basic drawing, I bring it to these people, and they can handle this, and they you see the final product after it. It's a USB connector for GPS or smartphone.
Yeah, you can see the little USB port there. That's interesting. Yeah. Go ahead.
That's already the model and the form from this chain protection. Okay, small nose, compact nose. Yeah, they correct the symmetry of the bevels. You see the surface, how it's very shiny.
Here and what are you doing here, Stephane?
Yes, here we prepare a part that's which will be glued on a WAW and which will serve as the connection for the rear suspension. This was added later, so we created a special part to glue on the WAW.
Okay. Go ahead, Carl.
This is a part for this rear suspension.
Okay.
A new tail that we created with integrated lights. This is again this new tail. It was created for the receiving the new rear suspension. We need more space for the chain and the derailleur. This is a reinforcement that we glue nowadays inside the WAW. And we adapted also this bridge after having done a finite element method analysis. It was done by a Hungarian student. So he came with good ideas to reinforce this part.
So you're always looking to upgrade and to improve your product, of course. And so sometimes you you actually did this guy submit this to you, or were you looking for some ideas and you looked for him?
This guy has contacted me. There are many people interested by Velomobiles, and I'm open to work with all companies and people who are interested. There must be we have to find a common subject. But in this case, it was really interesting to do this work with Laszlo, and I learned a lot of it. Yeah? And without him, I would not have been able to do it. So it was very nice cooperation.
It was a fortunate meeting. That's great. Okay, mm-hmm. Back to the pictures, please. And go ahead. Is this where you make sure everything fits properly?
Yeah. This is a new part. In fact, we worked on a model. You saw the picture of the model, and here we see it mounted on a bike. So this part was a success from the first attempt, which is not always true.
Mm-hmm.
Here you see, in fact, another Velomobile is the Sunrider. So we also sometimes offer services or help for other companies in the Velomobile sector or in the special bike sector using the network that we have.
Mm-hmm. That's, and if you will look, there's two or three pictures here about this other Velomobile. Could you take just a minute, Stephane, and talk about the interactions between the Velomobile industry companies, because they're actually kind of a close-knit group. Could you talk for just a second about that?
Yes, in fact, it's like a big family. So it's a small world, the Velomobile world. It's all still a small world market too. But what is nice is that we have very good relationships with all people working in it. And of course, we will not give the last secret, but we exchange ideas, solutions that somebody found, and we try to cooperate where we can, where we see a win-win situation. We try to work together.
In terms of production, sometimes you can help each other out, is what you mean.
Yes, or purchase too, because uh-huh. the turnovers are small. So if one is has a good purchase position and he can buy some parts or let produce some parts for the other, then everybody gains of this because the purchaser becomes more important also with the company where he buys, and he can negotiate better prices. So that's a good thing.
Yeah, it's a very amazing relationship you guys have. I just wanted to make sure we bring that out. All right, back to the picture. Thanks, Bryan. Okay, and there's the Sunrider again. I think that's the last picture of that, right? All right, I think, is that about it for that section? Let's go on.
That's about all the pictures for the molds and
the models.
Forms and the models and the molds, forms. Yep. And now we will see pictures of the production where we produce the parts.
Yep, all right. And... here's the preparation. So yeah, go ahead. This is where it all starts, really. This indicates where it all starts anyways.
Yeah, this is still a picture where I design a new part. In fact, it's not really the production of the parts. Huh? So we can skip to other pictures.
Next one, please, Paul.
Yeah, here you see the cutting of the fibers. Yeah? The yellow is Kevlar. It's very difficult to cut. We use it for this properties. It's very tough, and it adds something from safety in the bike. So he has a mechanical knife for cutting this.
Keep going.
They have shablons to cut this, so they prepare everything on beforehand. The white is a glass fiber. They always start for technical reasons with a very fine glass fiber layer. Okay. And here they prepare, they clean the mold. This is a very important job before starting to laminate, cleaning the mold and applying wax or separating products. You can go to faster to the products.
Yep, go pictures ahead, Carl, because, every few seconds.
Yeah. So here they cut carbon fiber. Everything is prepared well. Here they prepare special paste, which they will put into the sharp corners. This comes later. Here they spray the gel coat. The gel coat is the first layer that will stay on the bike. It also contains the color and a protection against penetration of water. Depending on the color, they can put more layers. Yellow, for instance, contains very low pigments, so they have to put more layers. Also a white layer to have a good effect of the yellow color.
So that's why certain colors actually cost more to produce than others. Is that right?
In our prices, there is no difference in price, but there is a difference in weight. If you order a yellow WAW compared to white or a black, he can easily weigh 1 kilo more.
Wow. Okay. Continue, Carl. Go ahead.
Again, cutting of layers of fibers. Here they spray the gel coat, orange color.
Wheel covers, were those wheel covers?
Yeah, wheel covers and nose. So here they fill with this paste the sharp edges inside the form, because otherwise if they would laminate on it, they would have a bubble and it would pierce towards outside of the bike, and this would not be nice to have for a customer. I think here they apply already the thin glass fiber layer.
Stephane, while we're going through these pictures, I've got a question here from Andy Hurst. Looks like it belongs here. Do you vacuum the resins into the fiber, or do you just paint it on?
No, we don't vacuum. We have done tests, and the gain in, or let's say the reduction in weight was very low, and there was a lot of waste material and it was very time consuming. So we don't vacuum. It's the hand application of the epoxy, but they do it very dry, let's say. They just put enough and they strike it out very well, so you don't have too much epoxy in a product.
Continue, Carl.
This is also possible because these are people, it's really their job. Yeah, they do this the whole year round. If I would do it myself, the result would by far not be as nice. Here they start to glue reinforcements in the body. This is maybe also something typical of the WAW, which allows to work with Kevlar. We have in fact the skelets glued inside the WAW, which gives the rigidity at important places. And the other places are in fact more like a skin, where we then can use Kevlar, which is not the most rigid material. So all the reinforcements, you see them here in black, they are all made in carbon fiber. Here they apply this paste, which works as a glue too. And then it has to dry for one day. So in fact, it takes 4 days to, with this form, they will need 4 days to make a product because it's work in steps. These are other forms of the nose fairing. They are in fact repeating the same actions now. This is a tail in glass fiber, and they add black pigments in the epoxy so that the product from inside looks black. It's also to have a better effect of the color from outside that's not transparent.
So, and that's something you told me the other day, so that whether you order your Velomobile in carbon fiber or in fiberglass, you're going to get a black, it's going to be black on the inside anyways.
Yes, aesthetically you don't see the difference from inside. Mm-hmm. There is a trick, carbon fiber will pass current. So if you want to check what it is, if you have doubt, then you put a meter, electrometer, you measure if you have a resistance. And if you haven't, then it's carbon.
So then it follows that if you were to be out in a thunderstorm, you'd be better off being struck in a fiberglass Velomobile than a carbon fiber Velomobile. Is that fair to say, Steve?
Well, I should try it out.
I don't think you should, no. Sorry, go ahead.
So here you see this pigmented epoxy. This is a wheel cover. This is the compact nose with the integrated lights. This is the bottom of the same part with some waves for the heels. Where we drill holes, we like also to have some glass fiber above the Kevlar, then the hole will be cleaner. Mm-hmm. Because Kevlar will make this hair, which is difficult to remove.
I think we saw that on some of the cutouts.
Yeah. Here they connect, in fact, the upper and the lower part of the nose. So they are first prepared, open, and then the forms are put together, and then they have to connect the product inside.
Okay, and now I guess we move on to the finishing part of the parts. Let's see what goes here.
So parts are removed from the mold, and then some edges have to be cut off.
Okay, Carl, go ahead.
Yeah, so the parts has to be cut off too. We draw in the forms, we have drawn lines, so they are visible on the product, and then the guy knows where to cut. We have jigs for drilling holes, always on the same place. This is very important if you want to standardize your product. So for every hole today, we have chicks. Now we see the process of removing the part. As the parts are thin, you can go to the next pictures because
there's a lot of them. Carl, just kind of every 3 or 4 seconds, just give us another one.
The product, in fact, is very thin, so also not very strong. So removing them from the foam for some forms can take a lot of time because you have to do it very carefully. This is a mirror cup. Forms need to be cleaned afterwards. This is the most difficult, remove the central part from the body, from the foam.
It kind of reminds me of cutting a diamond, you know, where you do all that work and try to determine what the best place to cut it is, and then making sure if you make a mistake, you just start all over again.
Yeah, they put pressured air in it, so it pushes the product out of the foam. Almost there.
Almost there. Et voila.
Yeah.
I think, is that it, Carl?
Yeah.
I think that's it. Yeah. Very good. Okay, Stephane. So that was great. It really gives us a good idea. Now we can actually lay our eyes on what happens in the production of all those parts. So you've contracted to get all that stuff made, and you bring it into your shop where you are now. And yep. I think we're about to take a look at the next step, if we can. You're going to take us on a tour, show us around, and show us what happens actually in your shop to finish off and construct full wow. So are you ready to go ahead and take us
yes,
around?
Yes, we are ready.
All right, let's go.
So I show you, we are now in the office. We have very nice offices since we moved 2 months ago. Veronique and Xavier are working here too. Everybody does a lot of different jobs. Veronique is also doing the financial and the administration, but she helps also with pre-assembling some parts. Xavier also, he works with pre-assembly of electrical parts, and he also does the website and gives me a hand when I need it. So we will make now a tour into the workshop.
And if I might just interrupt a second, Xavier was also intricately involved with getting us all set up here with the show. He was very helpful in putting everything together, so we wanted to thank him again for that publicly.
So here we have the workshop. It's divided in some parts. We will visit now the upper part where we store all the components. So in these shelves, we have all the components. When we walk through it, we see easily what is missing. When we need to order, it helps visual management. And to give you an idea, we prepared here all the parts for the next WAW that we will assemble. They're all here on this table.
Where is that WAW going?
In fact, this is the WAW which goes to my daughter, Veronique.
Oh. All right. Because that's not as exotic as I thought you were going to say. It's going someplace to like the Australia or something, but that's fine. That's fine. Go ahead.
Yeah, I sold her previous, so I had to give her a new one.
Okay.
So this WAW, it will be more a traveler WAW with electro assist, with Marathon Plus tires, more comfortable WAW with roll off also. So, don't know if you want to go into some details, but here you see, for instance, a lot of aluminium parts for the support of the seat. This is then made by another partner company, didn't only show pictures of this laminator, but we work with many other partner companies.
Yeah, just so, go over, take another section and then hold it steady so they can see all the parts. You can quickly describe what we have there.
Yeah, so the seats you saw, then the wheels, the frame where we mount the cranks, the front wheel suspension, the steering rods and the suspension of the front wheel, the steering handle with the switches for the electric systems. Here are other electrical parts, lights, horn, turning lights, rear lights. There is a PCB board for it. Then we have the engine with the battery. Here we see some polycarbonate plates, parts, the visor, in support of the visor, the covers for the rear lights. Here's the pump, the rear suspension. And then we are back at the rear wheel and the chain protection and the seats. Mm-hmm. So this is picked up by Veronique or me before the production starts. It's then always on the after we receive a specific order from a customer. Till now, we make in fact on order.
So this is I just want to make sure I understand. So this is the process when you get an order, you assemble all this on the table just like this, whether it's Veronique or somebody else. And you assemble the parts and then begin to, you put them on the table, make sure everything's there, and then you begin to assemble, yes?
In fact, we put them in boxes and we bring them down. It's just mm-hmm. for you that we now put okay. it on the table. Yeah.
Thank you. So okay.
We bring them down. And here is, in fact, the room where we assemble the bikes. The assembly is done today by one person. His name is Karel. We can grow now. We have more place. And we hope that we can grow in the future. So I've put some WAWs on the table. I will not show how we mount them today. It will be too difficult. But I will show you some different configurations of a WAW.
Yeah? Excellent. Please, go ahead.
So you saw already on previous pictures the central part. This is the most complex part. This is WAW 328, which will be for my daughter, Veronique, and which we mount next week. We have other parts already there prepared on the shelf. And depending on the choice of the customer, the WAW can have a totally different character. Yeah? This is, for instance, a sportive WAW. It is made out of carbon with a classical gearing system, triple in the front. And in the rear, we have a 10-speed cassette. On this one, we put an oversized tire and no rear suspension. It's maybe a little less comfortable, but if you have acceptable roads, then the result is very, very good. And it's lighter, so it's more sportive. Yeah. For aesthetic, we put some fiber caps and visible carbon. And next WAW is an example of the other extreme. This is a very comfortable WAW, which can easily be used for comfortable travel. It has rear suspension. It has also an electro engine. I can show you a little bit how it works from inside.
Stephane, if I can just 1 second. One of the things I learned when I talked to you last year at Spezia about the WAW, I think is unique to the WAW, is the removable front, the nose and tail sections for access. Is that fair to say?
Yes, that's specific for the WAW, I think. other Velo bikes don't offer this. And all these wows here, you see how easy then the access becomes to the parts. Yeah, you remove the front and you have immediately access to the cranks, in this case mm-hmm. also the engine.
Mm-hmm. Okay, go ahead with your...
And the tail also, that's a very big advantage, I think, for maintenance. It increases a little bit the complexity of the construction and has to pay a little bit on the weight for this, but it offers many possibilities. So I show you inside. The seat can be lifted. Don't know if you see enough inside.
Yeah, there you go. With the light, it's very visible now.
You have the battery. You can put the battery on. The display, you can move it under the knees if you want to get out of the bike. Then you can put it on.
If you could turn your camera down just a little bit, we can't quite see the... That's it. Thank you.
So now the engine is on. You can choose the program that you want. If you want less or more assists, there are till 9 levels. I put it on 5 now. And if you pedal then.
You can pedal by hand. It's so easy with that.
This is 250 watts, mm-hmm. but it's already at 40 kilometers per hour. Of course, he has no resistance for the moment. But this is another way of doing Velomobile with the help of this engine. This is a bike that goes to the United States for Daniel. He has ordered a roll-off. So this is also maybe typical for the WAW that you can almost put any type of transmission in it. Or so you have the classical with derailleur, or you have the roll-off. You can mount S-round dual drive. You can mount a Schlumpf in the front. You can mount an engine in the hub or an engine on the cranks, a mid-drive engine. So usually, if Karel starts on Monday, when he leaves the week, he has finished at least one bike. He can do a little more. All depends if we can pre-assemble the parts. This is the goal for the future, that we will prepare more the parts better, so then he has less work and then he could finish the two bikes. It also depends on the type of that bike that he has to make. This sportive bike has no electrical system, for instance, so it takes maybe one day less to build it.
So in general, it takes about a week or so to build one, but your goal is to at some point be able to build two a week. Is that what you said?
Yeah, for sure. So okay. Now we have the space and now we can start to think how to build more efficiently.
Yeah. May I ask how long it takes from when someone orders until it gets to their door? How long does that take?
Let's say... it will take 1 month and a half till 2 months.
Okay, that's not too bad. And people, I had this as a question, but a lot of people have also asked this question too, asking how many workers it takes to do what you do. And it's kind of a complicated question because there are workers involved with making the parts and assembly. So could you just address that again quickly? How many people does it take to put a WAW together?
Yeah, let's say I evaluated in this company in Slovakia where they do the laminated parts, that there are two people working only on the Velomobiles. In fact, more people work on it, but if we would just count in man hour, it would be two people. So at the rhythm of one per week, two there, one here for assembly, and then for the pre-assembly, take also, let's say, at least half a person, so 3.5 person in the production. Of course, all parts need to be ordered and sales needs to be done too. So there's more people needed than only production.
Sure, sales and marketing are important as well. So I'm gonna ask about that. Go ahead.
This is another bike which will go to United States for Jeffrey. And this is the way how we pack it. So we create special crates. The front wheel, they fit, in fact, in the they go in the hole. I will show you the hole. So they slide in it. And then the wheels are blocked. And the rear also, we block the bike. The nose fairing can go, the tail fairing can go on top of the nose. So then the crate is more compact. And then we close everything and we can ship it. And shipping is then less expensive because it's more compact way of packing. There's another advantage of this, of the WAW, to be able to remove this fairing parts.
Mm-hmm.
Now we enter into the showroom. So we have now also possibility to start selling in Czech Republic, which we didn't have before because we were working from home and for our office work, and production was done in a house in the woods somewhere. But now we have a nice showroom and we will start to offer sales and service of Velomobiles, not only the WAW. Also, we want to include other types of Velomobiles.
Stephane, could you lower the camera a little bit? We can't really, that's better. Now we can see Veronique too.
So, and Veronique will give you a short presentation of the our electric system.
Yeah. Okay.
So she will put the lights on now.
Yeah. Back up a little bit so we can see the whole thing.
This is the daylight. Yeah. In daylight, you can put flashing lights. Okay. And then you can put also this light in the mirrors. It's a very strong lights. Too strong for using during the night, but during the day you want to be seen, so this is good for it. Also on the rear it will be flashing. You can put it on permanent light too. So you can leave it on. There is a brake light too.
Okay.
Yeah, so the brake light is the upper part.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Okay. There is a horn. Yeah.
That sounds like a bird being killed. I don't know.
Yeah, that's, you're right. We are looking for a better...
but it does get turning. Attention. It does get attention. Yeah.
This is the turning light.
Uh-huh.
And then we have also in front, we have two lights. And one is set a little lower and the second is set higher. Can you do our teleflash?
Down. There you go. Down a little.
Yeah. If you put the light out here.
Yeah.
No, it's not. Okay. So.
Ah. Okay.
So it's dark outside. But
yeah.
The effect is probably not so nice to see. So we can go back to the office now.
Okay. Very good. While you're walking back up there. I wanted to ask you, here's another question for you. Who are your customers? Who are the people that order the Velomobiles? Are they previous recumbent riders, perhaps, or people that just are absolutely new to the whole idea of carless commuting and that sort of thing? Who are the people that buy these Velomobiles?
Let's say it's not black and white. You have a little bit of everything, but I have the feeling that more and more there are people entering into this world who didn't drive a recumbent bike before, but which are motivated to use less of the car and just use this type of bicycle, which is more comfortable than a bicycle.
Absolutely.
And they it's healthier. So more and more people in Europe are attracted to this idea.
All right. Now, I have a lot of people ask me this question, and it's kind of proprietary, so you answer if you feel comfortable with it. If not, maybe you can give us a ballpark figure. People want to know, how many do you manufacture in a year?
That's no secret. We are a little under 50 per year. Yeah. So we try to have the rhythm of one per week, which in some periods we are able to maintain, and in other periods sometimes not. Yeah. We had when we work a lot on the products, all the R&D that we did, it was a very difficult time because it really asked a lot of work. and then you cannot invest in marketing and so on. So, and then we had this move, but I think we will go over the 50 in the near future now. So,
and that kind of leads me to my next question about the market in general. So do you think that the market is growing? Is it quickly growing, maybe slightly growing? What do you see?
It's not yet quickly growing, for sure not. Since I started 5 years ago, I was hoping that it would grow faster, but that's not the case. But there are still a lot of people who see this product for the first time. And I also strongly believe that the fact that you can easily add an electric engine and make an electric bicycle of it opens this type of vehicles to a much broader market. Yeah? So okay. I believe that it can change. It will always stay a smaller market segment, I think, but it can easily become five times bigger, I believe.
And I assume your two biggest markets are the European market and the American market. How do you compare those two?
I think the European market is especially in some countries, they are more used to it already. So there are much more bicycles there. And then owners of a Velomobile, when a new product is on the market, they sell their older and they buy new. So sometimes you see that there is a little saturation in this market because when a new product comes out, people change their bicycle and a lot of second hands is on the market. And then there are countries where it's, let's say, newer. I think the United States for the moment is reacting, picking up positively. The last 2 years, I have the impression. And there is still a very big potential there.
Luke, go ahead and unmute yourself and go ahead. You have a good question. Go ahead and ask. Unmute yourself and you can ask Stefan.
Stefan, what is the percentage of the WAW that you're manufacturing that are e-assist versus the ones that are just human powered?
It depends a lot on the countries, I would say. In some countries, 2/3 is with e-assist, and in other countries, it's the inverse. Yeah, it's people who use it more like a solution for commuting or for transport, they often choose for an electrical engine, especially if they live in a country where there are more hills.
Out of the 50 that you manufacture every year, how many are electric assist?
I would say 25%, but I work with dealers, and there are dealers who like to mount themselves an electric engine on it. So the real proportion will be higher than this 25%.
Okay, very good. All right, let's kind of finish up here now with, we talked a little bit, you were talking a little bit about the effort it takes to market. You know, we talked all about the production, but you do have to market and maintain a business. So marketing your WAW, how do you go about doing that? What advertising, do you do trade shows, word of mouth, do you sponsor special events? Give me an idea what you do to market your product.
Okay, so for market, we have the same approach as for purchasing. In fact, we try to work with partners. We work with dealers, at least if we can find a dealer. So in markets where we don't have a dealer, there we sell directly. But as soon as we find a partner who has the skills, mainly the technical skills and the entrepreneurial skills and the motivation to launch himself in this business, because it's not, you don't do it for earning money. You hope not to do it and have a little earning of it, but you need really to be motivated to do this. So as soon as we have a good partner there, then we try to send our customers or the demands from our customers to these dealers. So this is the way of selling. We don't really invest in marketing. And today, except Spacey, for instance, there we are present every year. But it's in fact the only fair where we pay a booth to be present. Today, with all the social media, people talk, and it depends on how they perceive you, if they talk well of you on your product or bad. So we try to satisfy all our users and customers, and then they will speak about it, and then we receive demands from other people. So that's in fact the way how we work today, and we can do much more, and we will do more, but it has to be step by step. First, the product needs to be good. Now, the next step is now finish the technical manuals, which will help the user of the WAW to maintain himself, to do small repairs. And then when this is finished, then we can put more focus on active marketing and increase the sales level.
Very good. Stephane, I've got, we're running out of time quickly here, but yeah. I've got a few questions. If you can just give me real short answers to these. Let's see. Well, first of all, Larry Varney and a number of other people say, I want one of those. That's not a question. Zachary Mormon asks, tiller steering or skid steer?
Yeah, the WAW comes today with tank steering. And I have for the moment no plans of adding in the options tiller steering. It would demand a big modification in the WAW. And let's say for the moment, it's not on the agenda.
All right. Mike Croker asks, why crank drive rather than a motor in the wheel for your e-assist?
Yeah, there are pros and contras. The mid-drive or the crank drive has the advantage that it is before the gearing system. So you can use it as well to go slowly up the hill, or you can use it to increase your maximal speeds to travel faster without being too tired. So this is an advantage of the mid-drive. Disadvantage is that you will have more often to change your cassette or your gearing system. But it's much more economical in power, let's say, because the engine will turn on optimal turning levels.
Okay. Doug has asked, I don't know, I think we might have lost Doug here, but he messaged me asking about weight and endurance. So those are common questions any Velo pilot gets.
That should be here.
Oh, are you there? Doug, go ahead, because I'm not sure what you meant by endurance.
So one of the things that we always get asked, certainly I get asked all the time, is how much does it weigh? And there's a range depending on what the configuration is. And then how far do people typically go with it? Because people are astonished when I give them my mileage.
Yeah. The way it's like you say, it depends on the configuration. The sportive WAW that you saw without electrical system, in carbon, without rear suspension, but over tires, rear tire. So this will weigh something like 27 kilo. Yeah. And then the orange one with the engine and so on, the rear suspension, the Marathon Plus tires, it can weigh 38 kilo. Yeah. Then you can go very far with the WAW, probably with other Velomobiles too. Most of the WAWs are still in circulation. It's you can almost always repair it. Sometimes it's not worth to repair it, maybe, but the body can be repaired. I don't know if this is an answer to your question, or was your question maybe how far can you travel with it? I traveled last year to France with it to visit my family, and I did in 1 week 1,700 kilometers. So for me also a discovery to really see how the WAW behaves on such trips, and I was very satisfied and very happy to do this.
All right, very good. And I guess this is a question on everyone's mind. It's one I asked you last year too, and it's there's a range to it, I'm sure. Can you give us just a ballpark figure? What sort of price how much money does it take to get into a WAW? I know there's various levels. Can you give us an idea about pricing?
I can. you can also have a look at our website. There is a price option list. It takes about $7,000, I would say, for a basic version of the WAW, which will already contain a lot of options. Yeah, so it will be a good WAW. This is without transport cost, which is of course varying very much for the destination. For the States, you should add at least €1,000, so $1,000 and a little more dollar. And then it will be shipped to your door in the crate that I showed you.
Okay. And one last question here from Saki. Does the WAW come with car paint? I think he means paint on it, or is it only gel coat?
It is only gel coat. Yeah. Car paint would demand more work. We would have to grind the gel coat off and apply car paint on it. So technically, it's not impossible, but it would be a lot of extra work hours.
All right. And we have all kinds of people answering the question before you get to it. It's amazing. All right. Stephane, I think, I was going to ask you if you rode and Avello, which you've already answered that you do. So that's great to hear. I'm going to, at this point, I have a few questions that are more general about Velos that maybe we didn't cover last year's show. So if you want to stick around, I hope you will, maybe answer some of these questions anyways. But I want to open it up to our Velonauts that I have on the show. If you guys are on mute yourself. And I want to see what, just kind of, if we can, make it brief if you can, because we're running out of time, of course. What sort of person should consider purchasing a Velomobile? And Stephane actually answered a little bit of that. You guys want to tackle that?
Well, if your commute is somewhat longer, and if you want to ride year-round, a Velomobile is a very good idea.
That's a concise answer that I was looking for. Thank you, Josef. All right, here's one that I know one of you guys, or maybe all of you, can talk about. You all, from the posts that I see from Velomobile riders, you talk about a special feeling that you get when you're riding in your Velomobile. And I think most recumbent riders do have a special feeling when they ride, but I think you talk of something that's a little different. Who wants to talk a little bit about what that special feeling is like?
You know, it's kind of like when you first ride a bike, you get a feeling of movement, freedom, what have you. But it goes away over time as you're riding because you get used to it. With the Velomobile, it comes back over and over again. You get it when you go down hills. You get it when you go through bridges. You get it when you're passing a pack of roadies. It's just a continual feeling of being able to move under your own power.
Okay. That's Doug, by the way, folks. And we've got a problem with your video. I don't know what it is, Doug, but thank you for that. All right, let's talk about maintenance. We saw a little bit of the WAW and how the nose and the tail come apart so that you can maintain it. But in general, that doesn't go for all Velomobiles. Can you talk a little bit about the special problems with maintenance because of the enclosed design, tires, chains, that sort of thing? Who wants to take that?
Well, I'll take a stab at it. I think that in a Velomobile, what you will see is that while it has most of the components of a bike, it does have some special parts that you have to learn about. I think that the idea of Stefan of having a user manual is very important when you have a Velomobile. You have to be somewhat more mechanically inclined than the average cyclist, because you will need to do some repair yourselves, and you should know what to do. I think that in some cases it depends on the Velomobile. Some Velomobiles are easier to access, while some others are a little bit are better designed for accessing. Like the WAW is certainly a better design from an access point of view. Some of the components, for example, in let's say a Quest, which is a very popular model, have to be accessed from footholds at the bottom of the Velomobile at the front. If you want to change, for example, your crank or do some adjustments, well, some of it is accessible through the manhole, the cockpit hole that you have access to, and some of it is accessed at the back from the rear wheel well. And there's some access doors on some models, so you have access, better access to some of the components. It just depends on the model that you're using, but definitely it's a little bit more restrictive. On the pro side, however, is that the drivetrain is completely enclosed in most modern Velomobile, which means that there's a lot less maintenance of the drivetrain because everything is protected from the elements. So there's no grime on your chain and there's no water coming in. So you get a much longer run time with the Velomobile than you would with a regular bike. So you will put the lubricant on the chain maybe once a month as opposed to once a week on a regular bike if you drive the same distance.
Very good. Thank you, Luke. That's a very nice comprehensive answer. Let me go to basically the last question, I guess. A feature of Velomobiles that seems to set it apart, maybe more than anything else does, and that's the inherent safety of riding in a Velomobile shell versus just riding a bike. Who would like to talk to us a little bit about how that shell protects the rider in various circumstances?
Well, you know, in the unfortunate event, Gary, that you get hit by a car, and we have a number of cases over in Europe, but I guess also in the U.S. Now, where riders were unfortunate enough to be hit, it usually will push you aside. You know, that may not work for trucks, but it certainly works for most cars. It will rather push you aside than run you over. We've had a couple of cases where people were pushed off the road or went down a slope on the side of the road and rolled over a couple of times and still walked away basically unscratched, because the shell takes a lot of the beating that you suffer. Usually you stay inside and you get a couple of bruises on your arms or shoulders maybe, but normally you will walk away better than you would on most bikes. Now, apart from also that you can, since your center of gravity is very low, you can decelerate very quickly. So you can brake very hard, but also when you hit something, you will not be catapulted over the steering bar like you would on most upright bikes.
Yep, that is absolutely true. And yeah, I've seen a lot of those posts as well, Josef, about automobile accidents with Velomobiles and such, and although they're all horrible, that they do seem to be very survivable. So hopefully that will continue to be that way. So yeah. Great answer there. All right, lastly here, we're going to go back to Stephane. Stephane, I just wanted to ask you at this point, unmute yourself so we can hear you too. I wanted to ask you if we had missed anything that you wanted to talk about in our questions. Any final thoughts?
No final thoughts. I think what you're doing there is really great. And maybe I just want to thank you, but also all our partners, our suppliers, our dealers, because it's a big family. My kids too. It's a big family. It's a big adventure. And it's really nice to work in this environment.
Well, Stephane, it's been absolute pleasure having you on. Like I told Carl a little earlier, I don't think I've had anyone come on the show that's worked harder than you have to make it a success with all the pictures and everything you did to make it work so well. I thank you very much. I look forward to seeing you in a couple months. Look forward to seeing you at Spetsy again this year. and talking some more with you. I hope you'll stick around if you have a little time. I know it's getting late there in the Czech Republic, but if you want to stick around while we finish up the show, you're more than welcome to do that. But once again, thank you very much, Stephane Boving from Katanga.
Thank you, Gary. Thank you all.
Very good. All right, let's move along to the next section of the show. We're going to have Josef Janin talk to us a little bit about his brand new Velomobile. It's a new style of Velomobile with not three, but four wheels called the Quattrovelo. And he also has something to do, a little announcement about a tour that he's putting on. So, Josef, why don't you go ahead and we'll show a few pictures and you can talk about the tour too. Go ahead, Josef.
All right.
Bryan, if yeah, you can start with him if you want. There you go.
First on the Quattrovelo. I was very curious in it from the beginning. The guys at Velomobile.nl, the builders of the Quest, they have, in Strada, they have been working on it for the past 2 years and have put an immense amount of time and thinking into it. The interesting thing with a Quattrovelo is that it's a new story in terms of the stability of the machine. On a tricycle, your center of gravity has to remain within the triangle that is formed by the axis of the three wheels. With a four-wheeler, this space changes quite. Compared to a Quest is rather sensitive in the bend. So you really have to learn how to put a Quest through a corner on higher speeds. With the Quattrovelo, you fly through those corners as if it was nothing. At the same time, a four-wheeler will have a very different behavior when it comes to the rear suspension. On a three-wheeler, you want that suspension to be pretty stiff because that will determine a lot the ride agility of the machine. My experience with the Quattrovelo is that it can be very soft at the tail. The suspension is plush, but the road feeling, the road handling, is like if a sports car. It's quite amazing. I have around 1,200 kilometers on the clock now. I've had it for a good 6 weeks, and it's a very interesting ride.
Very nice. Can we go to the first picture here, if you want? I'm sorry.
Yeah. This is a picture.
Yeah. There we go.
That's a picture from riding back from Taunton to Bonn and home. That my first long ride, 285 kilometers in a day, and I wasn't quite satisfied with the machine. So if you want, you can go on with the pictures. Because it wasn't fast enough for my taste. Now I have tuned the drivetrain. I've basically by oiling it and by controlling the suspension and the air pressure, and now it is about as fast as a Quest, and it climbs super. This is the picture that's outside of my hometown. It's up in the mountains, and the Quattrovelo has a double freewheel rear axle, which means that both wheels are driven. And when one wheel goes faster, like on a corner or because it's losing traction, the traction always goes to the slower rolling wheel. And I've tried it out in the mountains there. And even on icy and wet surface, I can get it up a mountain better than I get my Quest or a DF, even though it is somewhat heavier. Turn on the next one, please. This is a part of the rear suspension. I think the complicated thing of the Quattrovelo is that it takes a totally different design for the rear axle. And the way that Velomobile has done it is very complex. So they have a double air spring system. And you see one of those springs in the picture. Go on, please. And there's also a double oil damping system. So you see one of the dampers there. And on the left, you see a bit of the Panhard rod, which is an anti-roll rod. So when you have a fixed rear axle, you don't want this to induce a roll movement to the whole chassis. And this is, you also find that in, I think, older cars with a rear axle that they use a Panhard, so-called Panhard rod, to control the possible rolling of the vehicle. And it's all very nice and clean. Here you see the entire rear axle. You basically look down at it from above into the machine room there in the back. In the middle, you see the cassette. To the left and right, you could still mount two disc brakes. You know, some people order that. You see the Panelists rod at the bottom, and there's another rod that goes from the rear axle forward that you can't see really from here. And the freewheel is basically sitting inside the sprocket. Go on, please. Yeah, here you see me replacing the derailleur cable. There is a, underneath the Quattrovelo, there is a little hatchet, there's an access that is normally covered with a piece of carbon that is Velcroed on that allows you quite easy access to the rear derailleur and to working on the system there. Next piece. Here you see my Quest and the Quattrovelo pictured or taken, the picture is taken from above. And so it gives you a bit of a feel for the different dimensions of it. It's about the same length, but you see that the Quattrovelo has a pretty fat ass, a pretty big tail there, which also means that there is a whole lot of storage capacity in there. You can open that hatch that you see, which forms the rear, the turtle deck behind the head. You can replace it with a different one, which goes all the way over your head and has a visor. But that one opens and gives you access to actually a huge trunk in there. I still have not. I'm going to run a test. How many six packs of beer you can store inside that trunk? And I figure around 20, but I haven't measured it yet. Next, please. And I think that's, oh yeah. And this is a picture from the road somewhere in the mountains. It is to say that this machine, even though it is heavier than my Quest is, I guess it's around 35 kilos, it climbs very well and it runs very well. You see the two front lights. It's like Stefan's wow. The two lights give a very good view at night. They are positioned higher than they are on the Quest or the DF. And you know, the two lights being a bit apart helps visibility greatly. So I love the light at night.
All right.
That should be the last one. Yep.
Yep,
so much for the Quattrovelo.
So much.
You'd like to know?
Yeah. Anybody have a question on the panel? All right. We're gonna leave it there then, because we are again running behind. Josef, thank you so much for taking the time to tell us about your experience with Quattrovelo. It's a machine that's garnered an incredible amount of attention, and now I guess we know a little bit why. I'm going to hop in one at Spezia again this year and get that feeling and see what it's like, and I hope to see you there. Are you coming to Spezia this year?
I guess I will.
Well, I guess you'll have to. We'll see you there. Thanks so much, Josef. Let's, at this point, I'm going to move along and let Bryan do his bit here. He's going to do the news report and the sports report today. So, Bryan, let me, there you go.
Hey.
Yep. Present to everyone. There we go. Everybody seeing Bryan?
Hey, everybody. Everybody got me all right? Okay. We have a few news items today. Not a whole lot. It's still wintertime, so we're not getting a whole lot going on, but a few things happened actually just in the last week here I wanted to get to. I hate to start out with bad news, but we had one sad thing happen. The bike industry really lost, especially the recumbent industry, lost a really true legend this past week. Chris Cagle, he was the founder and the driving force behind Wheel and Sprocket. It was a huge dealer, one of the most successful bicycle shop chains in the country, and also, especially in the early days when I first started Bent Rider around 2000, by far the largest recumbent dealer in the world, and sold a whole lot of bikes. He was also a huge advocate for cycling safety and other cycling advocacy projects. He unfortunately passed away this past week after a fairly short battle with cancer. It was very sad news when he got sick, and even sadder when he passed away. If the family is asking if you want to do anything, you can donate to the Chris Cagle Foundation, which is going to keep funding a lot of those advocacy products or projects that he had going on. There's a link in the description if you want to click on how to do that. Very worthwhile cause. Moving on, also this week, SRAM has announced they're going to stop making and producing internally geared hubs, which may not sound like a big deal, but to the recumbent industry, it kind of is. SRAM provides a lot of internally geared hubs and solutions for the recumbent industry, especially a TerraTrike uses their hubs extensively. And also SRAM Dual Drive is like standard equipment on HP Velotechnic and a couple other brands, has been for many years for all of their products. It's kind of early going. This was totally unexpected and we all just found out this week. So can't say what the future is going to bring for that, what people are going to be switching to. But from the people I talked to, it sounds like this year's production isn't going to be affected. That's already been ordered and stocked, you know, for the coming year. But in the next year or two, be interesting to see what people wind up replacing their SRAM hubs with. And lastly, Cruise Bike released some wind tunnel tests this week, which was kind of cool. It's very rare for a company to do that. They actually went and rented a wind tunnel used for racing cars in Charlotte, North Carolina, which is kind of the capital of motorsports in the U.S. And they put their bikes through the test there, a Vendetta V20 with their racing bike with several different riders. There's a link in the description again. I'm not going to get into all the technical stuff, but very interesting results, especially when it comes to their much better improvements than they thought with their small carbon tail box that they're going to start offering soon, and also a couple of customer-designed accessories they also tested while they're there. So very, especially if you're very technically minded, very interesting. That's also in the description below to click on. And going from that to, I guess I might as well just go right into Denny's sports report, because a cruise bike was very busy this last week in that regard also. First of all, we're going to talk although about a Schlitter Encore rider, Alan Johnson, 60 years old of Phoenix, Arizona. He set the record for 60-year-old plus in the male division in the UMCA highest mileage record for 1 month. He averaged 133.6 miles a day for a total of 4,007.5 miles. It's more than I do in a year sometimes. That's pretty good. The record attempt took place during 30 consecutive days between November 25th and December 24th. He was crewed by Julie Johnson. I know that's Arizona, but that's still probably not the month I'd pick to try and do that. And the Dallas Senior Games also went on this past month. That's an event for riders 50 and over. I'm sorry. This is coming up. I got ahead of myself. They're going to be adding recumbents this year, and that's going to be March 4th and 5th. On March 4th, there will be a 5K and 10K time trial and a 20-mile road race. On Sunday, there's going to be a 40K road race. The recumbent division is divided into trikes and bikes. You'll be in your age group of 50 to 54, 55 to 59, 60 to 64, 65 to 60, 70 to 74, 75 to 80, 85 to 90, and 90 to 94. Or as far as it goes in 5-year increments, depending on how many people they get in each event. So, and men do not race against the women. It's in separate categories. There's no electric assist, no fairings at all. So as far as we understand, Velomobiles and stuff like that are not going to be eligible for that. But bikes and trikes will be inspected for safety equipment before the race starts. It's going to be held at Texas Motor Speedway in Fort Worth, not in the speedway, but at the speedway. You're not going to be running around the high banks or anything like that. From what I've read, I think they're setting up a course in the parking lots, which are quite fast. This sounds like a good opportunity to test your racing skills. It would be great if there was a big turnout for the event. As you well know, recumbents are seldom welcome any racing contest, and we very much appreciate them opening their doors to us. Again, you'll be able to find the link in the description down there to find that. The big event this past week was they had the Sebring 12 and 24-hour races down in Sebring, Florida at the Sebring Motor Speedway. Always a great event, always with some impressive results for the recumbent people, and this year was no exception. We had, first of all, in the 100-mile race, Jim Parker of Cruise Bike was first overall with a time of 4 hours, 17 minutes, and 36 seconds. He bested his effort from last year by just 11 seconds, but that was an amazing run. We also had in the 12-hour race, over a third of the field were recumbents or HPVs, which is pretty cool. The overall first place in HPV was a Velomobile piloted by Dave Lewis in 12 hours. He covered an incredible 319.3 miles. He did the first 100 miles in 3 hours and 45 minutes, which is insane. And he was 33 minutes ahead of the rest of the entire pack at that point. The second overall finishers were the recumbents of Sandor Cormas and Alex Strouhal in a dead heat with 268.7 miles. They rode together all day and finished side by side at the end, 9 miles behind multiple Ram finisher Marco Bello, the overall winner on the day. Recumbents ran strong all day long, but Bello, who has raced Sebrings many times in the past, was just unbeatable. He broke away from the pack after the first 100 miles and stayed ahead all the way. Age group winners in the 12-hour were Sandor Cormas, Kyle Larson, Chris Miller, Alex Strouhal, John Schlitter, and Alan Doom. And I hope I'm saying that right. In the female 12-hour recumbent race, Tanya Pankratz and Connie Swenson won their races. Tanya had a respectable fourth overall women's finish, just falling short of third by just a little over 2 minutes. In the 24-hour non-drafting race, Scott Manning, Scotty Steinhardt were 6th and 7th overall. Paul Gagnon, a good friend of mine, was 11th overall. All three won their age divisions. In the 24-hour non-drafting Ram qualifying race, recumbent riders Kim Rowe and Gary Alexander won their age groups and virtually tied with 361.4 and 361 miles, respectively. The big story was the women's race in the 24-hour non-drafting division. Maria Parker was an outstanding fourth place in a race that saw two upright finishers finish with 494.5 miles. Maria was second overall in women, finishing behind Sarah Cooper, who was the overall winner of last year's Race Across the West. Both Sarah and Maria are entered into this year's Ram. Sarah is a solo rider and Maria on a four-person team. We, of course, wish the best of luck to both of them. Both of them are very amazing athletes. And this is from Denny. Some of his personal observations about this year's race. He said the 12-hour race had a very large contingency of recumbent bikes. The Schlitter Veet bikes and the Cruise bike teams were incredibly strong. Although a two-wheeled recumbent didn't get the longest distance this year, a Velomobile did. But the two-wheelers worked very well together beautifully. It was very fun to watch. I suspect the numbers of recumbents in this race continue to grow even larger in the years to come. And lastly, we're going to give an update on the Amanda Coker, who we've had here on the show before. I'll go ahead and call her a friend of the show. Amanda Coker is still racking up the miles at Flatwoods Park in Florida. She's going for the record for the most miles in a year and doing a very good job of it. As of this past weekend, week 39, her total was 62,876 miles with an average of over 230 miles a day. And the days are just getting longer.
Hey, so Bryan, let me just jump in for a second because yeah. Denny updated that. I think you're reading his report from before.
Uh-oh.
And so, oh, yeah, no. End of week 40. We don't want to slide her since we
oh, no.
continue to be a friend of the show. So end of week 40, your total miles were 64,530 wow. miles, averaging over 230 miles a day. And yes, the days are getting longer.
Yeah.
She's putting in bigger miles. And her attempt, as you were about to say, ends, what, May 14th?
May 14th, so, yes. So continue to stay tuned of me misquoting facts.
You didn't misquote at all. You just didn't see that there. So he had updated yeah. and you didn't know. So,
yeah.
Bryan, that was wonderful. Thank you for taking
all
on
right.
the extra duty.
No problem.
You didn't even do that. So I'm going to, I'm going to switch it, I guess, back to me, and then I'll let you take over from there for right now. And we're going to go to the Google Plus community, recumbent bike rider community business. And then over to Carl there so we can get the picture in. Can you get that?
Getting there.
There we go. Okay. So, yes, there's the community. There's the community picture of me on my trike. We have, at this point, hit the 1,083 member mark. Thank you very much, all the new members that we've been getting, and we're adding you to the map there as quickly as we can. So continue to fill out that little locator form, and we'll put you in there. Now let's move on to the contest, the picture of the month, first of all. The winner of the picture of the month was Ken Kaiser. It's called Transporting My Trident Stowaway. Just a great shot with the sun shining right behind it, put on his car there. Nice shot of that, Ken. Thank you. Next, move to the video of the month winner, Marco Ropers, my moderator for the community, always contributing a lot to the communication on the board. He contributed this video. Actually, he found it. He didn't actually shoot it. Greenspeed Rail Recumbent. You will want to take a look at this video, folks. It's a Greenspeed put on train wheels, little, and I don't know what that's called, half scale or something. And this kid rides this green speed way laid back like that all around a little course that I think his dad made for him. So kind of cool stuff. That's the video of the month. Discussion of the month. Our good friends, the Lovegroves from England, are about to embark on a long journey to Asia. They're going to be in South Korea and in Japan, I believe. So they have this picture from a previous tour of theirs, and there was a nice discussion around what they're going to be doing and where they're going to be going. So thank you, Julie. And I know Julie's watching today. I saw her pop up in the chat. So thanks for watching, Julie. We appreciate it. And the Pilius Pulcher picture of the month. Once again, another winter shot. I think these will be ending eventually, but I don't know what's more beautiful than shots of Pilius's trike with that winter background. He does it every time to work and back on New Year's Day. And there it is. All right. If you want to come back to me, if you could, Bryan. There we go. So at this point, I'd like to say a little more about linear folding recumbents and that special offer that we mentioned earlier in the show. And then let's get that shot in there for us. Thank you. Shorter riders have a hard time finding a recumbent that will fit them well. Now, riders down to about 5 feet tall can choose between the relaxing linear minier limo long wheelbase and the sportier minier roadster short wheelbase. Both have folding frames, and just like the larger folding linears, they'll fit in small cars and the Crateworks travel case. With linear recumbent bikes, it's easy to bring your two-wheeler on an airline trip or keep it safe and dry in your car. Yes, you can even fit one behind the rear seat of a tiny Prius C. Now, here's that special limited time offer exclusively for Laidback Bike Report viewers from Peter Stoll of Linear. Mention the Laidback Bike Report when you order any folding linear before March 15th, 2017, and get your choice of these two special deals. 50% off shipping or a 30-day test ride. That's right, you can try it for 30 days and return it for a refund if you are not delighted. And if you want to bring it back to me then, please. Yep. So for more info on all this, you can go to the Linear Recumbent Facebook page. You can call 607-587-8835, or you can go to www.linearrecumbents.com. And we'll, again, like Bryan keeps telling you, we will be posting all this information, all these links and numbers on the description below the video right after the program ends. So thanks a lot, Linear. Thanks a lot, Peter Stoll. And now we're going to go to the final portion of the program. Let's head over to talk about what's coming up. Can we get that picture? There we go. So next month on Laidback Bike Report, it's going to be March 5th. It's just a couple of weeks away, and it's going to be at 3 p.m., so note that later time. We're going to be talking with Doug Grosjean about bent riding and the law. So I won't give too much of this away, but I will tell you that Doug has posted in a couple of places about his encounters. He has this Velomobile that he rides everywhere. He is car free. He rides this to work, commutes, of course. In the last 2 months, he has been stopped by the police over 70 times. So there's a bit to talk about there. We need to see what's going on. And if any of the rest of you have encounters with the law on your recumbent bikes, we want to hear about that as well. So please contact me. All right. So that's going to be next month, March 5th at 3 p.m. Okay. If you want to come on back to me here again. Very good. Okay, at this point, I want to thank a few people. First of all, let me do this. I want to present Bryan. Come back, Bryan. See, you muted your picture there. I want to say, there you go. Bryan, thank you. Wait, cool. No, you can't.
I unpresented myself. Oh my gosh.
We're having dual presenting here. Presenting.
My triple duty is not going.
You did a great job. I can't thank you enough for Bryan really took up the slack today because we didn't have all the panelists that we usually have. So Bryan, thank you so much for the directing, for your great reporting, for reading Denny's script, and you and Bent Rider for all the support you give us all the time. We really appreciate that. Look forward to going to with you. So thanks a lot, Bryan.
All right. Thank you. And I'll show you some cool spots in Germany. So
yeah, and you're the man to ask.
As long as you don't tell anybody about it.
No, I will not. Of course, my lips are sealed. All right, let's go to the next panelist here. Let's talk to Luke. How about putting Luke on here? Go down the line, Bryan. I'll just thank him as you go.
Oh, okay. Hold on.
There we go, Luke. Luke's a last-minute addition to the panel, and I know he's a busy guy right now working on a lot of stuff at home. So, Luke, thank you so much for joining us and your contributions today. It's always a pleasure having you.
Thank you very much. And if anybody's curious, I hope to start over the blog on the Velomobile Observer probably in the spring when I have a bit more time.
And tell us where they can find the Velomobile Observer. Luke.
It's Velomobile Observer at blogspot.com.
Very good. Thanks again. All right. Who are we going to talk to next? Go ahead, Bryan. Pick somebody. All right, Josef. There we go. Josef, always willing to pitch in and help out when it comes to Velomobiles. I don't know anybody who knows more about them and rides them more than you do. I sure appreciate you coming on and look forward to, I guess, seeing you at Spetsy again this year.
Thanks. Been a pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you, Josef. All right. How about maybe Larry? Larry, there you go. It's always good to see you. Happy birthday again. Thanks for being on. And we will see you again soon. Thanks, Larry.
And if anybody's looking for something to get me as a belated birthday present, one of those Quattrovelos or the wall would be perfectly fine. So,
or a couple of them, I'm sure you wouldn't turn down. So very good. And how about Carl? Can we get Carl on? There we go, Carl. Thanks, buddy. Boy, that was there was a lot of pictures today.
We all did a great job
through those at the clip we needed. So thank you, Carl. As always, we sure appreciate you.
It was my pleasure. It's a great show. Now I want to get a 3-car garage so I have some place for my new WAW, because all I need is to be WAW-WAWed now. I would want one, but nowhere to put it. But great show. And, by the way, the weather's fine. Any of you Northerners, come on down. It was probably about 80 degrees today and sunny. So,
very good. Thank you for taunting us, although it's getting nicer up north here. So
rub it in.
Yeah, we'll keep the light on.
All right. Thanks. All right. And thank you, of course, all of you who watched today. We had a great audience, a live audience. A little mix-up with the link at the beginning, but looks like you all came through. We have plenty of people watching, and we hope you'll watch later on YouTube if you have a chance to do that. I wanted to talk a little bit for just a minute about the recent trip that we took to Florida, where we saw a bunch of people, including Carl and the group. We stopped and rode with the Crabs of Central Florida and Phil Mix, a wonderful recumbent group of retired guys down there. Rode a couple times with them. Thank you, Phil and Crabs. The Bent Society of South Florida. Yes, we were there riding with Carl and Wanda and Bob and Drawer and Arnold and Jim and Yorick. So thank you guys. A little shout out to you guys. We went to Trailside Bike in Floral City where we rode the Withlacoochee Trail. And we stopped in to Trailside Bike and saw Gary and Greg. And we missed Andrew, but Andrew's the new owner there. So thanks a lot for all the help you gave us while we were there at Trailside Bike. And lastly, on our way back, we stopped in Greenville, South Carolina, and rode the Swamp Rabbit Trail with George Varn. George was very nice to take us around and show us a good time on the Swamp Rabbit Trail. So thanks, George. We appreciate that. Now in the announcement section, I alluded to it a couple times today. Yes, we are going back to Spetsy. So I hope you all look for our 2017 Spetsy video special. That'll be out in May sometime after we get back and have a chance to edit that together. That would not be possible without a major sponsor who was Tom Floor and tried in trike. So Tom stepped up and helped us out with some sponsorship. We also have some patrons that also stepped up to help us out. So because of that, we're able to get back to Spezia. Hopefully he can give you another great video. We look forward to putting that together and having you guys watch that. So how can you guys support what we do on the Laidback Bike Report? Again, subscribe, hit that red subscribe button on any of our videos, or if you get to our YouTube channel, you can subscribe right there. You will look when you get to YouTube at the description below the video, as we talked about earlier, and not only will we have all the links that we talked about today, as we always do, we'll have a clickable table of contents so you can jump between the sections of a very long video, which this is going to be another one. So hopefully you can chew it up in parts. You can also go to Facebook and like us on the Laidback Bike Report Facebook page. We'd appreciate that. And again, that little white eye that may pop up there for more information on how you can help us, and also more information on past and present programs. We're going to show you what the website has in just a minute. All right. What else? Let's switch over.
Gary, yeah. Wait. We have Doug back. We have to go to Doug.
Doug,
it's good to has appeared. So you know, let's put Doug on the pick on.
Doug had to essentially go out and buy a new computer. And
it seemed like it, didn't it?
And everything. But Doug, we so much appreciated having your voice on and now having your face. So at least I can thank you near the end. You made it. Thanks.
What did you say? A face made for radio. Even Google knows how to blank me.
I don't know what happened. Maybe that was it. So welcome back, Doug. All right. Now let's go back. There we go. To this guy right here. That's the guy that wears the hat that models it every month. It's Larry Varney wearing the Laidback Bike Report hat, which you can buy on our website for $20, $5 shipping and handling. We're sending one out, I think, to Manitoba. Some lady just ordered one for a birthday present yesterday. So avail yourself of that if you'd like to wear one of our hats and help to support us. We appreciate that. Available again at laidbackbikereport.com. And here's, Carl, you want to pop up the shot of the video? There we go, of our website. And if you're at the website, at the very top, right below the header there, you're going to see all of our sponsors at the top of the page. And we would, again, encourage you to support our sponsors. They help make us possible. So take a look at those. You're going to see who we have coming up on future shows. You're going to be able to go to the past shows page. And you're going to be able to see all of our past shows, including the live chat archive we'll put right there. We have a bonus materials page, which has all of the videos and pictures that may not have made the report here, but you may be interested in seeing. So that's our bonus page. And you can sign up on the bottom of that front page for our mailing list. We will send you out a couple mailings, emails a month, not too often, and let you know the latest of what's going on at the Laidback Bike Report. Okay, and back to me, if you would, Bryan. If you're still doing that, I know I keep jumping in there. All right. And you can find all those things at laidbackbikereport.com. So until our next webcast, from all of us at the Laidback Bike Report, so long, Bet Riders.